So here for this episode of Vote with Elizabeth Freeman from Pick Your Own. It's been a while, Elizabeth, hasn't it, since we last spoke? Just tell us a bit about what Pick Your Own does, because I know we featured you before, but that was before even the first lockdown. It was just over a year ago, wasn't it? So
It was a lot's happened. January 20 we first spoke.
Yeah.
So thank you for having me back. Good morning. So Pick Your Own works with young people who have issues with confidence and anxiety and are, because of that, often isolated and withdrawing themselves. So the idea is that we offer a non-clinical, casual alternative to some of the more formal support out there, and we go and meet them in their comfortable spaces. So in lockdown, I was able to still meet with people outside and go and have a walk near their home and do a walk and talk and think about what we do. We use the language of solution focus, so we're always looking at what the young person's preferred future is. So that might be a future with more confidence, more ability to make friends. It might be a future where they're able to get back into education if that's gone a bit awry with them, or it might be getting onto a path where they are looking at some training courses, or it might just be, I need to engage with somebody and build a relationship with somebody and get out of this state of being in my home and in my room and
yeah.
really start from the basics again. So yeah, it's coaching, it's mentoring, and then it's facilitating whatever that young person wants, really. So starting from where they are, they tell me what they think they could do with a hand with, and then it's emotional and practical support to try and make that happen.
Yeah, it's been difficult, hasn't it, during the lockdown, and young people have really suffered, haven't they, a lot of them. And have you seen an increase in kind of people being referred to you or people wanting support, extra
yeah.
support?
I think I'm pretty busy. Yes, I'm very busy, actually. Lots of referrals from teams that work with families and children, and lots of referrals from parents. Lockdown has been mixed for many. For some young people, it's actually been a blessed relief, because if you take away the stress of attending school, that has been a huge benefit to some people. And so what I've done with some people is use that space to work with them on building up confidence and reducing their anxiety and looking at some strategies about how they might return to school in a better space and manage that situation and those stresses in a more confident way. So that's been helpful. And for others, it's been a case of sort of reevaluating where they're at. It's like, right, you've got this time now. Are you able to engage with online learning with school? Because obviously that's what they've been offered. And some have found online learning really, really difficult.
Yeah.
I think if you've got a additional learning need or some condition like ASC, autistic spectrum condition, or ADHD, or dyslexia, some of those neurodiverse conditions, actually learning from a screen and online is incredibly difficult. So talking
yeah.
to some of them about different ways of approaching it, different ways of learning it, and schools have been obviously working their socks off, teachers have been working their socks off, and all hats off to them. However, you can't really differentiate work when you're delivering through a screen, so you can't really give children work that suits them better. You've got to give more of a standard lesson. So, you know, it's been swings and roundabouts, really.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, do you think that people, children, that they're able to catch up? What's your experience of children that might think that they've been behind? Because I know that a lot of people in the education establishment don't call it catch up; they call it recovery. I spoke to someone from the National Education Union just this week, actually. So is that possible? Because people might be feeling a bit anxious that you know they've got fallen behind. But I mean, it's more. It's always been a marathon rather than a kind of a sprint anyway, hasn't it, education?
Yeah.
So it's a long-term game, isn't it?
To be honest, the young people that I support are not at school, engaging with school, able to access school, were like that despite COVID. That was going on anyway, for most of them. So it's been the whole narrative around catching up. There's been a lot of talk this week about maybe changing that narrative, because it's very much a linear narrative about catching up with curriculum content rather than the broader understanding of learning. So a lot of young people have had really amazing opportunities through lockdown to learn in different ways and learn in a more emotion-based way, as well as curriculum content. They may have learned to care for a sick relative. They may have learned to be more independent and do more and contribute more to the household. They may have learned more about nature and the environment because they've had more time and opportunities to go out in that. They may have done more about things like family tree because they've had more time to spend with their families. So I think we need to just shift the narrative away from catching up to looking at this generation actually being able to offer quite a different mindset to other generations that haven't had that opportunity. Of course, that's not for all of them, and some have been stuck at home without the technology, technological resources to access learning, with parents who haven't had the capacity to spend time with them because they've been working or unwell. So it's been a very mixed bag, but I wouldn't say the idea of catch-up is a helpful one, because it will deem this whole generation as a bit lesser, and we need to make that not the story, really.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that, as I say, it's not really, education is a lot more than just, you know, going to into lessons, isn't it? It's kind of more about engagement, isn't it? It's how you engage with the lessons and how you engage with the topics. And so,
you've got life skills as well.
Exactly.
You want the life skills. We've got young people that can now cook and can now do all sorts of things. Yeah. Sorry to cut you across.
Yeah. Exactly. So what difference have you changed about it? You work with young people at Pick Your Own. How's COVID-19 changed the way that you work?
So obviously, depending on where we were at with rules, so I was able to start off by visiting people in their gardens, because that's, you know, some people that are really anxious and very homebound do not come out in the community. They're not ready yet. Their anxiety and their lack of confidence doesn't enable them to do that. So the fact that I could still go and see them, just be in the garden, so you know they're still in a safe space, that worked very well. As the regulations tightened, I then shifted to those that were able to get out of the house. As I said before, we go for a walk and a talk, two people are allowed outside, especially if one of them's in a work role, and always the offer was to go with my dog or not. Pretty 99% of young people like me to bring my dog along, because that's a nice focus. And it means, you know, any conversation is not heavy. It's not a really heavy and deep conversation. It's more of a chat, and we chat around the dog and we throw the ball. And that is much more accessible to young people.
Yeah.
And then other young people that are not coming out of their house, I've become very accomplished, as have you, with Zoom and FaceTime.
Too accomplished.
And use that technology. And again, you know, it's quite tempting with Zoom, because you're both seeing each other face to face, to make it really deep and heavy.
Yeah.
So those that I Zoom, rather than do the dog play, we do games, and we've learnt, you know, charades and Scriblio, which is a sort of a Pictionary version on Zoom, and we'll play whilst chatting. So again, it's always under the umbrella of chatty conversation and addressing stuff, rather than tell me how you feel and let's fix this, because that is just not the way people want to be spoken to. It's too heavy. It's really hard to answer. It's like, how are you feeling? It's a hard question to answer. But if you say, you know, what do you want to do? it's a little bit easier, and we can think, oh yeah, we can work on that, we can have a look at that. So it's always got a light touch.
Yeah, exactly. Just before we finish up for the first half then, I mean, how do people contact Pick Your Own if, you know, parents that are listening in might want to contact you?
There is a website, which is Pick Your Own Brighton.
Yeah.
There is email, is Elizabeth, Elizabeth at Pick Your Own. Elizabeth.pickyourown@gmail.com.
Yeah.
They can text, so Pick Your Own phone. 077-254-72346. They can just text me and then we can take it from there.
Brilliant. All right, that's it for the first half. Join me for the second half. I'll be speaking a lot more to Elizabeth Freeman from Pick Your Own about the issues with children's mental health and also the lockdown and how that's affected young people. So back here for the second half of the vote with Elizabeth Freeman from Pick Your Own, and we're talking a bit about more about education and how it's affected young people. I know we've been speaking off camera about, you know, how people, children might be returning to school. I know you think that some children might never return to school because they kind of get out of the habit or they find it very difficult. Maybe there should be alternative ways of learning and education. I've always thought that was kind of, there's no one size fits all approach really. There should be different approaches, shouldn't there, to the way that young people learn, because we all learn in different ways. There's no, it's different in every person.
Exactly that, Mark. Yeah. One size fits all has proven to be quite jaded now. So, you know, pre-COVID, there were an enormous amount of young people who were being disrolled from school, so off-rolled, sorry. So parents who just felt that they could not witness their child experiencing so much distress anymore, because the level of anxiety and distress around attending school-based education was too much. So these aren't parents that would normally choose to home educate. So, you know, a lot of, there obviously were always a cohort of parents that were choosing to do that, and that's fine and great. But these are more, you know, your everyday parent who want to go to school, who want to go to work and send their kids to school, and found that actually the level of poor mental health and well-being in their child became so enormous that they felt they had no choice but to take them out of school. And the difficulty with that is that funding for a child's education only stays with them if they are on roll after school. So once they are off-rolled, the funding for their education returns to central government. So that is a bit of a problem, because what would be ideal, and what I'm working with on and having discussions with some colleagues, is offering an alternative education setup where you've got a kind of portfolio education for young people. So they have a timetable across a week where they might be accessing well-being, therapeutic, coaching type sessions to work on their anxiety and confidence, but also then engaging with activity. So I'm talking to a guy who runs a lot of football sessions and works with refugees and other disadvantaged communities, and he's offering well-being through football, and then the opportunity for young people to gain coaching qualifications so that they then got opportunities to build a life in that direction if they want. I'm talking to a woman who is very connected with fostering and adoption service to look at better opportunities for looked after children, because their trajectory is pretty poor outlook. So the idea is to have this portfolio timetable, is to have children have the option to choose. It might be sport, bit of drama, bit of art, do their English and maths, maybe functional skills if GCSE is not accessible to them, or GCSEs if they're able to access that level of learning, and build a learning timetable, like I said in the first half, which is much broader, that enables them to learn in a way that they can and build their skills and experience to enable them to move forward in their life in a way that works for them and doesn't penalise them for having anxiety or low confidence. It doesn't penalise them for having additional learning needs, and actually allows them to learn in a way that results in success.
Yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, have you got any ideas about how that, what that might look like then, this kind of alternative way of learning? I know there's forest schools, for example, isn't it? There's kind of, well...
So it would be sport, my ideal, sport, forest schools, music, drama, traditional subjects like English and maths. I am registered to deliver AQA units. So AQA units, you get, it's not a formal qualification, but it helps them engage back with learning and gain confidence. So you can do an AQA unit in any subject you like and learn in a way that works for them. So once they get back into that, build their confidence, they could then go on to do any, you know, ordinary mainstream subject that they like doing. So I've got a young woman that's really interested in history and museums, and we can do something like that. Another young woman that's really interested in psychology, so we can start with some groundwork around that and then build up so that they can then join these subjects in a more formalised environment. So, yeah, the alternative is to go out and engage with a variety of experiences that not only enhance your well-being physically and mentally, but also give you the broader definition of learning experience.
Yeah, so have you entered into discussion with the council? Because I'm guessing that this would be need funding from the council, or
I haven't yet. I think it's very difficult because the council, as is everybody, are really struggling financially. So I am, as I say, talking to colleagues about how to go about this and which is the best avenue to secure funding. We're looking at potentially, you know, charitable funding. We're looking at corporate sponsorship. And there may be ways where we can have a think about unlocking some of that money that is attached to each child, where it doesn't return to central government and it can be used for them locally again. So there's lots of ways that we need to work this through. But I think the evidence is loud and clear. There are there's been such a massive increase in young people that are now not attending school and off-rolled that we need to think of a alternative way of providing them with education.
Yeah, just a bit about I know about mental health issues. ADHD is one of those issues I know you want to raise as well. Talk a bit about that. And
yeah,
I know we're coming
so
up to... Carry on.
So in my other hat, I volunteer for an organisation based in Brighton and Hove called ADHD Aware. And they support adults with and affected by ADHD. So they offer support groups and discussion groups and work with partners and families. I recently, during this year, started a group for parents of children with ADHD because it's quite a lonely space out there, struggling to know how best to support them and feeling quite judged and working with the system. So we have put together a little film that we made during lockdown, so it's Zoom interviews and some input from a young person with ADHD and a teenager with ADHD, and the idea is to try and raise awareness so that people don't just see it and the child as a problem, but sees their wonderful creativity and lateral thinking and all the positives that ADHD can bring, and try and break some of those myths and stigma around it.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, is it more diagnoses of ADHD and autism, and is there more kind of, are you seeing that?
There's a really, really massive waiting list. It's a 2-year plus waiting list to get assessed. So if you're a child who is really, really struggling,
yeah,
and school are saying, you know, I hear you, but actually we've got no diagnosis, so we don't know whether he's got that or not, and we're not sure. And there's a 2-year delay before anything can be properly confirmed. That's a lot of time for a child to fail to access the curriculum, but more importantly,
yeah,
have their self-esteem bashed, you know, and to come out of it really feeling quite low and disaffected. So we're just trying to work around not just relying on a diagnosis, but actually just to get general higher understanding around it, and so that people can adopt some approaches that are free and easy to use, you know, like be kinder, be warmer, understand how it manifests, and understand little adaptations that you can make that can make all the difference to a child with ADHD.
Yeah, okay, and I know we're going to see some of that film as well. That's just about it for now. Once again, how can people find out more about Pick Your Own, Elizabeth?
So there the website. Is a Facebook page, an Instagram page.
Yeah.
There is a website. You can text me. Number is on the website, and you can email me elizabeth.pickyourown@gmail.com. And I would love to hear from you.
Excellent. Okay, we'll leave it there. Thanks for joining us today, Elizabeth, and all the best for the future.
Thanks so much, Mark.
Thanks. Bye.